This is lesson 587, The Scourging at the Pillar, the Crowning with Thorns, from Matthew 27, Mark chapter 15, and John chapter 19. And this is a terrible, and I was going to say a painful lesson. Of course, it's painful for us to read about it. Our Lord went through it, and he suffered it for you and for me. But this is not easy reading. We'll start, though, with Matthew 16, right after Peter is given the power of the keys. Then Jesus said unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever shall lose his life for my sake shall find it. And what does it profit a man if he gains the entire world and loses his soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? Well, there's a question there. What would you sell your soul for? For money? For power? For health? For love? Well, I think, of course, none of these would make any sense. For the entire universe, you'd not sell your soul. But I think that people, when they contemplate this, or when they think about selling their soul, it's not so much to gain something, but it's to get rid of something, to get rid of suffering. People want $1 billion. Why? You want to get rid of the pain of poverty, or get rid of the pain of sickness, or the pain of uncertainty, or the pain of loneliness, the undeniable and unavoidable reality of physical pain. I don't know a single thing about you, dear listener, except that you suffer pain. Physical, mental, psychological, spiritual, you suffer pain, and we cannot avoid pain, mortal beings that we are. There was one man who could have avoided all pain. Jesus could have avoided all pain, but he chose it. He suffered it, and he did it for love of us. He loved us to the end. We believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of God. Jesus Christ, who suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. Catechism 572. The Church remains faithful to the interpretation of all Scripture that Jesus gave both before and after his Passover. What did Jesus say? Both before and after his torture, crucifixion, and death on the cross. Jesus said, It is necessary that Christ should suffer these things and enter into glory. It must be this way so that the prophets would be fulfilled, their prophecies would be fulfilled. Jesus' suffering took their historical, concrete form from the fact that he was rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, who handed him over to the Gentiles to be mocked, to be scourged, and to be crucified. And Jesus himself said that he would be handed over to the Gentiles to be mocked, scourged, and crucified. He was not a pawn being moved around out of his control. He was in control. He offered himself willingly and lovingly for me and for you. And why was it necessary? Why did the prophet say that Christ would need to suffer? Okay, I can understand that Christ suffered in fulfillment of the prophets, but why did Christ choose to suffer? Why did he do that? Well, it goes back to that one thing I know about you, that you suffer. Catechism 573. Faith can therefore try to examine the circumstances of Christ's death, and these details and these circumstances have been to us faithfully handed on by the Gospels and illuminated by other historical sources. But only in faith and prayer can we better understand the meaning of the redemption. There's nothing I can read to you here from the Catechism of the Catholic Church or from the Gospel accounts that you can't read for yourself. But to enter into the mystery of Jesus's redemption of us through suffering, we must pray. We must enter with Jesus. We must pick up our cross, deny ourselves, pick up our cross, and follow him, because suffering has been redeemed. Suffering can therefore have a positive side. Suffering can bear fruit. But I need to be careful here, of course. I am not saying that suffering is good. I'm not going to walk up to somebody who's in pain and say, oh, that's good. You're growing stronger. Of course not. Suffering and pain are bad. They are evil. They are perversions of the created universe. God created it to be good. The redemption does not mean that suffering is good. It means that suffering can be turned to good. It can be. Jesus redeemed us through suffering, and therefore Jesus has redeemed our suffering. Suffering can be part of conversion. It can, not always, but it can be part of our growing stronger, just like the pain of exercise or the pain of physical therapy can be part of the healing process. From Catechism 1435, conversion, and we'll talk a lot about conversion in this lesson. Conversion is accomplished in daily life by gestures of reconciliation, by concern for the poor, the exercise and defense of justice, by the admission of fault to one's brothers, by fraternal correction. Correcting others can be part of your conversion. Conversion is accomplished by revision of life, by examination of conscience, by spiritual direction. Conversion is accomplished in daily life by the acceptance of suffering, endurance of persecution for the sake of righteousness. Conversion is accomplished in daily life by taking up one's cross and following Jesus. And when I say that acceptance of suffering is part of conversion, well, we could be talking specifically here about the sacrament of penance. The sacrament of penance, part of which is not just confession, but also receiving penance and doing your penance. Catechism 1460, the penance the confessor imposes must take into account the penitent's personal situation and must seek his spiritual good. It must correspond as far as possible with the gravity and nature of the sins committed. It can consist of prayer, an offering, works of mercy, service to neighbor, voluntary self-denial, sacrifices, and above all, the patient acceptance of the cross we must bear. The confessor doesn't have to make you suffer. We know that you suffer. He knows that you suffer. Such penance help configure us to Christ, who alone expiated our sins once for all. They allow us to become co-heirs with the risen Christ, quote, provided that we suffer with him. That we suffer with him, that we take up our cross and follow him, that we suffer with him, and that is a great mystery. How can we suffer with him? We're talking about suffering in this lesson. We can suffer with him. From the Council of Trent, the satisfaction that we make for our own sins is not so much ours as though it was not done through Jesus Christ, because we can do nothing of ourselves. Without him, we can do nothing. Thus, man has nothing of which to boast, but all our boasting is in Christ, in whom we make satisfaction through bringing forth fruits that befit repentance. These fruits have their efficacy from him. By him they are offered to the Father, and through him they are accepted by the Father. Our sufferings can be accepted by the Father as a sacrifice to the Father because of Jesus Christ. He redeemed us through suffering. He redeemed our suffering. From John's Gospel now. Then Pilate took him and scourged him, and the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they put on him a purple robe and said, Hail, King of the Jews! And they smote him with their hands. The scourge was a leather whip with pieces of metal embedded in it. It was designed to rip away the victim's flesh. It was a torture for rebellious slaves, many of whom, when they were scourged, died. From 1 Peter 2:24, By his stripes you were healed. Jesus Christ, when he hung on the cross, bore these stripes. His body was destroyed from head to toe. He suffered horribly for us. And we pause now to remember when suffering came into the world. Genesis 3:16, Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrows at thy conception, and sorrow shalt thou bring forth children, and thy desire shall be for thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. And unto Adam he said, Because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, Thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all of the days of your life. Again, by his stripes you were healed. You were healed. The ground was healed. Human relationships were healed. And most of all, that gulf between man and God, that sin-inspired gulf that separated us from right relationship with God, is finally healed. And I pause now to, without in any way understating the reality of physical pain, to notice the other types of pain, emotional, mental, even spiritual pain. And Jesus Christ suffered all of these for us. That crown of thorns, I've heard it can explain mental illness or terrible psychological pain. And we remember that conversion is painful, and Jesus suffered this pain for us too. Conversion is painful. Catechism 1490. The movement of return to God called conversion and repentance entails sorrow for and abhorrence of your sins, and the firm purpose of sinning no more in the future. Conversion touches the past and the future and is nourished by hope in God's mercy. And Jesus felt that pain. Jesus took to himself all pain. Of course, Jesus never felt the pain of regretting and being remorseful for sins that he committed. Of course not. He led the perfect moral life, but he took that pain onto himself. He took our pain and our punishment and our pain onto himself. And pain can be redemptive. Suffering can be redemptive. It can bring us to conversion. Regret makes you human, by the way. If you don't have any regret for anything you've ever done, well, that makes you similar to a dog, a fish, or a houseplant. Dogs, fish, and houseplants all have very clean consciences. They've never done anything that they regret. Yet we do. I certainly do. And we all suffer and we all regret. But this suffering can be linked with hope. When we recall the suffering of Eve in childbirth, you will suffer in childbirth, but there will be hope there. Because through childbirth, daughters of Eve, eventually sons and daughters of Eve will eventually participate in bringing about the Messiah. We read Genesis 3:16 and 3:17. Don't forget 3:15. I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. The seed of Eve brought forth through suffering will defeat the serpent. We turn to Matthew's gospel now. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall and gathered unto him the whole band of soldiers, and they stripped him and put on him a scarlet robe. And when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand, and they bowed down the knee before him and mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews! And they spit on him and took the reed and smote him on the head. And after they had mocked him, they took the robe off of him and put on his own raiment and led him away to crucify him. Catechism 385. God is infinitely good and all his works are good. Yet no one can escape the experience of suffering or the evils in nature which seem to be linked to the limitations proper to creatures, and above all to the question of moral evil. Where does evil come from? I sought whence evil came from, and there was no solution, said St. Augustine, and his own painful quest would be only resolved by his conversion to the living God. St. Augustine had a painful conversion. You can read about that in his Confessions. Confessions for his sins. The mystery of lawlessness is clarified only in the light of the mystery of religion. The revelation of divine love in Christ manifested at the same time the extent of evil and the superabundance of grace. We must therefore approach the question of the origin of evil by fixing the eyes of faith on him who alone conquered it. Jesus Christ conquered sin and death. So no, I can't explain suffering to you, but you can pray with Jesus and enter into his suffering. You can suffer alongside with him. Catechism 164. Now, however, we walk by faith and not by sight. We perceive God as in a mirror, dimly and only in part. Even though enlightened by him in whom it believes, faith is often lived in darkness. Faith can be put to the test. The world we live in often seems far from the one promised to us by faith. Our experience of evil and suffering, our experience of injustice and death, seems to contradict the good news. They can even shake our faith and become a temptation against it. Lord, lead us not into temptation. 272. Faith in God the Father Almighty can be put to the test by the experience of evil and suffering. God can sometimes seem to be absent or incapable of stopping evil, but in the most mysterious way, God the Father has revealed His almighty power in the voluntary humiliation and resurrection of His Son, by which He conquered evil. Christ crucified is thus the power of God and the wisdom of God, for the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. It is in Christ's resurrection and exaltation that the Father has shown forth the immeasurable greatness of His power in us who believe. And we turn now for a final time through this painful passage of Scripture here, through this torturing of the perfect man, the torturing of Jesus Christ. We turn to St. Mark. And the soldiers led him away to the hall called Praetorium, and they called together the whole band, and they clothed him with purple and plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they smote him on the head with a reed, and did spit on him, and bowing their knees, worshipped him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple from him and put on his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. The word of the Lord. And suffering again. I'm not saying that suffering is good. I'm not even saying that suffering makes us stronger. I'm saying that suffering can be part of conversion. And suffering can be part of physical rehabilitation. And suffering was how Jesus chose to save us. And suffering is something that unites us together, all of us, every single human. And another thing that unites us, of course, is our mortality. So I'd like to end this lesson by talking about death in Catechism 2277. Whatever its motives, whatever its means, direct euthanasia constitutes in putting an end to the lives of the handicapped. It results in putting an end to the life of the sick or the life of the dying person. It is morally unacceptable. Killing in order to put an end to the life of an innocent person is morally unacceptable. But that does not mean that the church has no compassion, and the church does not wish to alleviate this suffering. We read back to the Catechism two paragraphs later, 2279. Even if death is thought imminent, the ordinary care owed to a sick person cannot be interrupted. The use of painkillers to alleviate the suffering of the dying, even at the risk of shortening their days, even if you know that the painkillers are going to shorten their days, you don't need to extend the life for as long as humanly possible. You don't need to have as many children as humanly possible. Even if the painkiller will shorten their days, it can be morally used in conformity with human dignity if death is not willed as either an end or a means. That's the key thing. You just can't want to kill them. You can't will death as the end or as the means. So painkillers can and should be used, even if they will possibly shorten the days. Nuanced, perhaps, Catholic teaching regarding end-of-life care. But it really isn't nuanced at all. It really is sticking to a very clear principle, and that is the dignity of human life. Because in Christianity, we look at our Savior beaten and mocked. He was given that reed to hold, like, oh, you think you're a king here, hold this reed. And given that scarlet robe. And how painful is humiliation? Personal, professional humiliation. How much suffering, both when it happens and the remembering being humiliated and gossip, and how painful is that? But Jesus Christ suffered that for us. God in the flesh suffered that for us, suffered all for us, suffered everything for us. He redeemed all our suffering. He took onto himself the penalty for all our sin. And we as Christians, we look at a crucifix and we see a man whose life doesn't seem to have worked out very well, you could say. We see a man beaten. We see a man mocked. We see a man tortured. We see a man dying. And we raise up our eyes to that man, and we know that that is the face of love, and that he loved us. And we look at that beaten, humiliated man, and we say, "My Lord and my God." And then we pick up our own cross and follow him. And this has been Lesson 587.